بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته And welcome to this special presentation on the life of Khalilullah Ibrahim عليه السلام The great prophet in Islam The prophet that was referred to as an ummah by himself And I think that's a great position to start on That if you look at the praise that Ibrahim alayhi salam has received either in the Quran or through the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself, it helps us appreciate who he actually was. So let us begin with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he was once referred to as Ya Khair al-Bariyah, that O you who is the best of creation. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, even though he is the best of creation, out of humility, He says, "Thaka Abi Ibrahim." He says, "No, rather that is our father Ibrahim alayhi salam, who was the best of creation." And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam referred to him as such. When you look in the Quran, you find that Allah subhanahu wa taala refers to Ibrahim alayhi salam as an ummah by himself. He is an ummah by himself. Now, often when we translate this, we say that he was a nation by himself. But in the books of tafsir, when you look at what ummah actually means over here, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created him as an imam, meaning one that is followed, one whose footsteps are revered and they are replicated to the best of our ability. So the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam was created as an example for all of humanity. And that is why you see that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Ibrahim alayhi salam as a qudwa, as an example. That should be followed by all of the believers. If you look at the level of love that Ibrahim alayhi salam has placed for him with people of faith in general, you will find he was one of those prophets that is greatly revered, whether it be in Islam, whether it be in Judaism, or whether it be in Christianity. All three of these faiths, they revere Ibrahim alayhi salam and have a great amount of love and respect for him. And this is a sign of his greatness as well. If you look at Ibrahim alayhi salam and the dua that he made in Surah Al-Shu'ara towards the first middle of the surah, one of the things that he asked for is وَجَعَلِّي لِسَانَ صِدْقٍ فِي آخِرِينَ that, O Allah, grant me a remembrance of the truthful ones or a truthful remembrance towards the end of time, meaning in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, how did that come to manifest itself? It came to manifest itself in the durood Ibrahimiyya that we say in our salawat at least five times a day. At least five times a day. So when we say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, right? That, O Allah, send your salah and salam upon Muhammad and his family, just like you sent your salah and salam upon Ibrahim and his family. So this remembrance that is made by the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their salawat for Ibrahim alayhi salam is one of the opinions as to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that he be remembered by the truthful tongue, the one that is praying in the end of time, meaning the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So these are just some of the virtues that we want to cover about Ibrahim alayhi salam in terms of who he was, in terms of his praise. Now let's actually get into his story. And there's multiple stories from his life that we want to cover. The first of them, we begin in Surah Al-An'am. In Surah Al-An'am, Ibrahim alayhi salam is a young boy and he is on this mission to prove the truth to his people. He's on a mission to prove the truth to his people. So his people, as you know, they used to worship idols. And we're going to get to his father, which is coming very, very shortly. But he used to create the idols himself, subhanAllah. So you can imagine that test that was placed for him. But his people used to worship idols. And Ibrahim alayhi salam wanted to prove to his people that they are worshiping something incorrectly. So how did he do this? As a young boy, he came up with a series of reflections for them. That when he saw a star, he said, "This must be my Lord." But he said, "No, my Lord does not disappear." When he saw the moon, he said, "This must be my Lord." But he said, "No, this is not my Lord, for my Lord does not disperse." And then he sees the sun and he says, "Surely you are my Lord. You are, you know, bigger and brighter and stronger. You must be my Lord." And then surely he is not my Lord. And he does this with a series of reflections. So you see, from a very young age, Ibrahim alayhi salam was granted this intelligence that if you can teach people to reflect and you can empower them to come to the truth, that is more powerful than preaching and dictating to them what the truth actually is, what the truth actually is. Now, his people, they used to be very bothered by this, that they were content in worshiping the idols. They were content in worshiping the idols and didn't want anything to do with Ibrahim alayhi salam and this monotheism that he was preaching, and this monotheism that he was preaching. And there are a couple of lessons over here that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had this high level of conviction inside of him, in his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and only then was he able to preach to his people. So that certainty that he had established confidence in him, and that confidence could easily relay in preaching to his people. And this is a very valuable point, that before da'wah can be given, we need to be certain ourselves of what we actually believe in, and knowing it inside and out as much as is possible. And that confidence needs to exuberate from inside of us, and that is something that will lead to giving da'wah. But if you do not have that certainty and you do not have that confidence, then this will have a negative impact on the da'wah that you are giving. Now, number two, as we mentioned, his father himself used to create the idols himself, used to create the idols himself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he addresses a wonderful conversation that Ibrahim alayhi salam has with him in Surah Maryam. And this is another beautiful thing about Ibrahim alayhi salam, is that his story is spread throughout the Quran. So every once in a while, when you're reading the Quran from the beginning to the end, you're going to keep seeing the mention of Ibrahim. And this is from his virtues that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make sure that we do not forget the remembrance of Ibrahim alayhi salam throughout the Quran. So if you were to refer to Surah Maryam, starting from verse number 41, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صَدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا. And remember in this great book, Ibrahim alayhi salam, surely he was a siddiq and a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was a man of truth and a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what I want to highlight over here is, how do you engage with someone, a family member, one that is particularly close to you, when they're on the exact opposite belief system as you? So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he represents monotheism, and you can imagine that his father, as a creator of idols, what does he represent? He represents the epitome of shirk. Not only does he worship those idols, but he creates them himself. Now I want you to look at these two verses, verses 42 and 43, as to how Ibrahim alayhi salam actually refers to his father. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, remember, إِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِي لِمَا تَعْبُدُ مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبْصِرُ وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا يَا أَبَتِي إِنِّي قَدْ جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِكَ فَاتَّبِعْنِي أَهْدِكَ صِرَاطًا صَوِيًّا. And remember when he said to his father, oh my dear father, why do you worship what can neither hear nor see nor benefit you at all? يَا أَبَتِي, oh my dear father, I have certainly received some knowledge which you have not received. So follow me and I will guide you to the straight path. And I will guide you to the straight path. And the conversation continues, where he continues to refer to him as Ya Abati, oh my dear father, oh my dear father. So what we learn from this is that even though they are in opposition to one another, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he shows this level of respect towards his father that is paramount, particularly when dealing with someone that differs with you. You have to show them that respect and show them that love, but most importantly, there should be that genuine concern for their akhirah, that genuine concern for their akhirah, for their guidance, and to be saved from the hellfire. And this is what Ibrahim alayhi salam is showing us over here, that his father, even though he created these idols and they were on opposing sides, Ibrahim alayhi salam still had this genuine love that a son would have for their father and wanted guidance for his father. So this shows us that that love and that genuine concern has to remain even though you are on opposing ends. And then we see this logical argument that again Ibrahim alayhi salam brings to his father. Instead of saying, oh my father, you know what you're doing is evil and you're being condemned to the hellfire, look at the argument that he brings. He says, oh, my dear father, why do you worship that which cannot hear, nor can see, nor can benefit you in any way? So again, he's trying to empower his father to come to the logical conclusion that idolatry does not make any sense, that idolatry does not make any sense. So rather than dictating, he's empowering his father to come to that conclusion. And this also teaches us a very valuable lesson. And this is something that needs to be reflected on, is that you can hear from the words of one of the most beloved prophets of Allah. You can witness the miracles that came with him being a prophet, and you can interact with him. But if it is not determined and meant for you to be guided, you will not be guided. Allahu Akbar. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself was told that you cannot guide those whom you love. Because you would think that, like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he loved his father dearly. He loved his father dearly. And had it been purely in the hands of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of Ibrahim alayhi salam would have accepted Islam. He would have accepted that monotheism, but he didn't. And this shows us that ultimate guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you do not give up trying to guide them. You do not give up trying to guide them. And this teaches us another valuable lesson, that you will be tested through your family. You will be tested through your family. And this is something that's very important to understand, that when you are tested through your family, you have to be patient upon that. We have the example of Ibrahim alayhi salam, who's tested through his father. We have the example of Nuh alayhi salam, who's tested through his son. We have the example of Lut, who's tested through his wife. And all of these prophets were tested through their family. And this shows us that one of the possible wisdoms and one of the possible benefits behind the families of the prophets not accepting Islam and not accepting their guidance is to show us that ultimately guidance is in the hands of Allah. And even the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation did not have that control of who is guided and who is not. So this is a very valuable lesson, that we may think we ourselves from time to time, we may feel righteous and we may wonder, you know, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not answering my dua as to these people being guided when I want them to be guided? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he teaches us this valuable lesson, that guidance is ultimately in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to keep trying. You need to keep making dua for them. You need to keep making dua for them and trying to empower them to receive the truth. Now, as a result of this interaction with his father and his father refusing, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he takes things a step further. And one day when his father and the tribe's people are away, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he goes and destroys all of the idols. He goes and destroys all of the idols except for one. So when his tribe's people and his father return, they see all of the idols destroyed. You can imagine how angry they are. You can imagine how angry they are. And they were very, very upset. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he tells them, go and ask the big one, the idol that's still remaining. And his people from that time, they understood that clearly the idol cannot move, cannot speak, cannot talk. Clearly the bigger idol could not have done this. And Ibrahim alayhi salam was just mocking them. And that is how they took it. Whereas Ibrahim alayhi salam wanted to teach them a very valuable lesson. Why do you worship that which cannot even protect itself? Allahu Akbar. Why do you worship that which cannot even protect itself? And they took out their rage on Ibrahim alayhi salam and they threw him into a cold, like a pit of fire, into a pit of fire. And when he did that, this teaches us another very valuable lesson from the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So now we've established that Ibrahim alayhi salam is giving da'wahs to people. We have established that Ibrahim alayhi salam at this point does not have any followers. And you'll notice that for the vast majority of his life, Ibrahim alayhi salam did not have any followers, did not have any followers. Eventually, his nephew embraces his message. Eventually, he has his own kids. But that is much later on in his life. So who does Ibrahim alayhi salam have in his life at this time? It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why when his father and the tribe threw him into the fire, what was Ibrahim alayhi salam's natural reaction? He said, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for me and is the best of all entrustees. He is sufficient for me and is the best of all entrustees. That there is no one and no thing that you will need after you have entrusted in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and done your due diligence. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he only had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he only relied upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was that statement that the believers from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to use thereafter. That Ibrahim alayhi salam used this statement and the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam embraced this statement as a good statement and started to use it in their vernacular. It became from the vernacular of Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But Ibrahim alayhi salam is the one who originated this statement. And that is from the virtues of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So now when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he makes this proclamation, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for me and the best of entrustees. Obviously, you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to respond to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And what ends up happening is one of those miraculous things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the fire, Kuni bardan wa salaman ala al-Ibrahim, that be cool and peaceful upon Ibrahim alayhi salam. And what's really interesting over here is that when you look in the books of tafsir on this verse, it mentions that had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not mentioned salam, kuni bardan wa salaman ala al-Ibrahim, that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he actually would have froze at that time because the fire, it would have frozen him. But the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, be cool and be peaceful and bring peace to Ibrahim alayhi salam, then this meant that the fire did not harm him and was cooling for him rather than causing him to freeze over. Some of the opinions mentioned that this happened with all fire, that fire rather than burning, it started to become that which freezes things over. But that eventually changed, obviously, for this particular incident or thereafter, or after this incident, rather. So it's a very fascinating miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Ibrahim alayhi salam to show that he was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to show that he was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that itself was one of the great miracles. And this is pretty much where the story of where Ibrahim alayhi salam and his people pretty much comes to an end. One thing to highlight over here is that Ibrahim alayhi salam did attempt to seek forgiveness for his father. He did attempt to seek forgiveness for his father. And this is mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah, that even though his father was upon misguidance and he did this evil treatment towards him, Ibrahim alayhi salam still wanted to seek forgiveness for his father, that he didn't want his father to be punished. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala corrected Ibrahim alayhi salam in this, that the father dying upon disbelief, it was not permitted that he should seek forgiveness for him. It was not permitted that he should seek forgiveness for him. And this is a valuable lesson as well, that you have to value life when it exists. You have to value life when it exists. That any dawah you want to give, you can only do when a person is alive. You cannot change their fate after they are dead. So if you want the best for them and you want the saving of the hellfire and the entering of the Jannah for them, then you have to give that dawah while they're alive. Because if they die upon disbelief, then you cannot seek that forgiveness for them, as was mentioned to Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Surah At-Tawbah. So this is where that part of the story ends. Now, two other stories that I want to highlight from the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam is, number one, when he is making hijrah from Philistine to Mecca. So to give you some background, Ibrahim alayhi salam, according to tradition mentioned by Ibn al-Kathir, is that he was born and raised in the Iraq area. And eventually he moves to Philistine, close to the Masjid al-Aqsa area. And then eventually he migrates to Mecca. And I want you to understand the context of this migration, that Mecca at that time is a completely deserted area. Completely deserted area. Perhaps there are a few trees. Everything else is just mountainous. And it is a valley in between the mountains. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded him to migrate here now with his wife Hajar and their young son Ismail. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's quite older in age now, and he has been blessed with a son named Ismail and his wife Hajar. And they arrive into the city of Mecca, but before it was called Mecca, it was actually referred to as Bakka. It was actually referred to as Bakka. And over there, he was commanded to leave his wife Hajar and his newly born son. And you can imagine the type of test that this is. You can imagine the type of test that this is, that he is commanded, leave them there when there is no food around, there are no people around, and there's nothing around at all. There's nothing around at all. So they arrive over there, and Ibrahim alayhi salam, he starts walking away. He starts walking away. Now, what's important to understand is that his wife Hajar, she used to also be a pagan. She was raised as a pagan, and eventually she ended up accepting Islam. So she doesn't have a deep-rooted understanding of Islam. But this shows us the power of guidance, that you do not have to be born within Islam to receive this guidance and to manifest that guidance. But even if you accept Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowers you with the truth. So look at what happens over here, that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he starts walking away from his family, leaving them in this deserted area in the heat of the sun with nothing around them. And they continue to call out to him. They continue to call out to Ibrahim. And they continue to ask, "Ya Ibrahim, where are you going? Why are you leaving us here?" And it is such a painful experience, you can imagine, for a husband leaving his wife behind without any visible protection, for a father leaving his son behind without any, you know, possible visible nutrition. It is going to be a very painful experience. So as he is walking away, he's trying not to turn around. He's trying not to turn around. And you can imagine that even tears may be coming out of his eyes at this time because of how painful it is. And after calling out, "Ya Ibrahim, where are you going?" Look at the iman, the deep grounded iman of Hajar. She shouts out from far behind, "Allahu amaraka bihada." Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command you with this? And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he knew at that time that through this deep grounded iman that Hajar has, that he is able to respond and that things will be okay. And he nods his head as he continues to walk away. And look at the iman of Hajar again. She says, "Falan yudayya'ana Allah," that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not allow us to perish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not allow us to perish. If you're fulfilling the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then know surely that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not allow us to perish. And this is actually, you know, subhanAllah, going from a situation where Ibrahim alayhi salam is worried about his family, Hajar is now consoling him. Hajar is now consoling him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of us and will not allow us to perish. And that is where the beautiful story of Zamzam takes place, where Ismail alayhi salam, as a young baby, was thirsty and wanted something to drink. And Hajar, she ran between the two mountains of Safa and Marwa to see from the top of the mountains if she could find a source of water or some people that may have some water that she could ask them for that water. And she ran back and forth 7 times till she found nothing. And in one narration, Jibreel himself comes and strikes the ground with his wing, and then the spring of Zamzam comes forth. And the spring of Zamzam comes forth. And had it not been for the request for it to stop, it would have flooded the whole area. It would have flooded the whole area. And thereafter, and this is something important to understand, that how did Mecca become a city? It was because it became a source of water. It was because it became a source of water. And thus the people started to surround them. And this is a part of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam that he makes for his family, that, "Oh Allah, surround them by people and grant them, you know, from the fruits that are a result of the of this water and provide for them. So the people finally started to come due to this water being present, and eventually you are able to go grow some fruits and some crops and harvest some things due to that presence of water itself. And that is how civilization started in Mecca. That is how civilization started in Mecca, through this incident of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam. And this is that miraculous, you know, event of Zamzam that we honor every time we go to Mecca. And subhanAllah, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us back after this pandemic is over and things start to normalize and keeps all of us safe. Allahumma ameen. But one of the beautiful aspects of finishing or actually doing your umrah is following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that after you make your tawaf and you pray your two rak'ahs, you go and drink zamzam and you wipe it over your face and wipe it over your head, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reported to have done. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us that zamzam is what it is drunk for, meaning that whatever intention that you make, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor that intention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor that intention. And that is why we've seen so many people be cured of their illnesses as a result of this Zamzam water, which the legacy of which goes back to Hajar, the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and this story. Now let's move forward a little bit. Some time goes on. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he comes back and he is commanded to build the Kaaba. So him and Ismail, they start building the Kaaba and they eventually finish. And for me, this is such a beautiful lesson in humility that I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instills in us, as in following the example of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that even though Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail, they were commanded to build the Kaaba, notice that when they finish, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from them. They said, Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim. That, oh our Lord, accept from us, surely you're the all-hearing and the all-knowing. And part of this is Ibrahim alayhi salam setting a good example for Ismail, but this good example was for all of humanity till the end of time. That it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that commands us to do good deeds. It is also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that guides us to do good deeds. Now, once those good deeds are done, one should just not naturally assume that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept those deeds. You shouldn't just naturally assume that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept those deeds. But rather, if they are sincere and they're in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for acceptance. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for acceptance. And this is a lesson in humility, that one does not presume that their deeds are automatically accepted, but rather you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept them. And this is what Ibrahim alayhi salam did as a lesson in humility for all of humanity thereafter, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides you to do a good deed, then ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from you as well. Now I want to move on to the last story for our discussion today. And this is perhaps the crux of what we've been waiting for. But Ibrahim alayhi salam being commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a dream to sacrifice his son. And you can imagine, and the message behind this is such a powerful one, that for a very, very long time, Ibrahim alayhi salam was not blessed with any followers and he did not have any children. And then finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with a child. And that is Ismail. In Judeo-Christian tradition, it was Ishaq that is in this situation. But from Muslim tradition, it is Ismail alayhi salam. And he says that you have to sacrifice your son as an act of gratitude, as an act of gratitude and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to sacrifice your son. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, rather than just tying his son up, he goes to his son and he has perhaps what can be described as the most difficult conversation that you can have with someone. That he says, oh my son, Allah has commanded me to sacrifice you. Are you okay with this? Are you okay with this? And this again shows us that when you put your trust and reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes things easy for you. Because Ismail alayhi salam, he did not rebuke, he did not retort saying, you know, this doesn't make any sense. How can we do this? Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command you to do this? It's inhumane, it's barbaric. He did not respond with any of those things. It is the deeply grounded iman that Ibrahim alayhi salam had, and that he was able to teach his children, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in them that very deeply grounded iman as well. And obviously his mother being Hajar definitely had a very, very big role in that. What does Ismail alayhi salam respond to his father? He says, "If'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'allahu min as-sabirin." He says, go ahead and do what you are commanded, and surely you will find me to be from the patient. And surely you will find me to be from the patient. And Allahu Akbar. And I think to myself, you know, in this moment, you do not know what the future is. Like Ibrahim alayhi salam does not know what the outcome is going to be. Ismail alayhi salam does not know what the outcome is going to be. Yet the level of faith and iman and tawakkul that they have is just resounding. It is amazing, right? He says, go ahead and do what you're commanded. You will find me from the patient. Meaning I'm not going to run away, nor am I going to stop you. And as a result of that deeply grounded iman, when Ibrahim alayhi salam was commanded to do so, and he was about to do so, what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced Ismail alayhi salam with a sheep. He replaced Ismail alayhi salam with a sheep. And that is where the sunnah of sacrificing the udhiyah actually came from. That is where the sunnah of sacrificing the udhiyah actually came from. This very story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this shows us that when you truly have deep grounded iman and you rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always take care of your affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always take care of your affairs. And this leads me to the last portion that I want to conclude this session with, is that with the days of Dhul Hijjah just around the corner, the days of Dhul Hijjah just around the corner. We are on the 27th of Dhul Qa'dah right now. So literally, we're about 3 to 4 days away from the days of Dhul Hijjah beginning. Let us understand that the scholars of Islam have said that the best nights of the year are definitely the nights of Ramadan, and the best days of the year are the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, as the best 10 nights are the last 10 nights of Ramadan. So just like we work extra hard in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, we need to exhort similar effort in these first 9 days of Dhul Hijjah. We need to exhort that extra effort in the first 9 days of Dhul Hijjah. So those are days of reciting Quran. Those are days of dhikr. Those are days of salawat, praying the duha prayer, right? Pray your duha prayers during that time, just like you would pray your qiyam al-layl and your tahajjud in the nights of Ramadan. So you do that during the daytime. And if you're able to fast, you're encouraged to fast as well for the first 8 days of Dhul Hijjah. On the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, it is the day of Arafah. And the day of Arafah within of itself is a remarkable day as well. It is the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave Adam alayhi salam. It is the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, basically forgives all of his slaves, right? So on that day, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says that whoever fasts on that day, and this is for the people that are not making Hajj, then those individuals, they will have their sins forgiven for the previous year and the coming year. So fasting for that one day will bring about this great amount of reward, will bring about this great amount of reward. Then comes the 10th day, which is the day of Eid, which is the day of Eid. And that is the day that the sacrifice should actually take place. So from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that on that day, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray his Salatul Eid very quickly after sunrise and keeping it very early on. And then he would go and sacrifice his animal and then would cook the animal and then eat from it. So for Eid al-Fitr, it's sunnah that you eat something before you go for Salah, Whereas over here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would eat from the udhiya that he would do, and that is when he would break his fast according to tradition. According to tradition. Now, which leads us to the sunnah of udhiya, that for the vast majority of us, we will either be doing it through a charity organization or doing it through a local grocery store, and we don't actually do it ourselves. So I'm not going to get into the fiqh of, you know, what are the conditions for the animal to be met. But what I will say is that the animal should be sacrificed after Salatul Eid. It should be sacrificed after Salatul Eid and not before Salatul Eid. And not before Salatul Eid. So if you're getting it done in another country, you want to try to time it in such a way that it is done after Salatul Eid, your Salatul Eid in particular. That is one of the best things to do. And same thing with the grocery store, tell them to do it after your Salatul Eid and not before that, and not before that. This udhiyah is not something that is mandatory, but it is a highly, 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 highly recommended sunnah for those that are able to do so, for those that are able to do so. And it should be one per household. If you're able to do more than one per household, alhamdulillah, that is great. But the leader of the household should do one on behalf of his whole household. And whoever has made the intention to do the udhiya, so if it's the leader of the household, or if there are other people in the household that are doing it as well, then for those first 10 days, up and until the sacrifice of the udhiya is done, then the clipping of the nails is discouraged, the cutting of the hair is discouraged as well. And that should not be done. And some of the scholars have mentioned, this is a way of, you know, experiencing the elements of ihram while a person is away. Because in the state of ihram, you're not allowed cutting your hair or clipping your nails as well. However, for the person that is doing this udhiya, it is only for them and not for the rest of the family. And even in that case, it is not haram to cut your nails or to trim, to cut your hair or to trim your nails. It is highly discouraged to do so according to the majority opinion, according to the majority opinion. So that is some fiqh related to that. That is some fiqh related to that. If you want to know more fiqh related to the udhiya, I just saw today that Al-Maghrib posted the Faith IQ video of Sheikh Abu Isa Ni'matullah, where he talks about the fiqh of udhiya. You can check out that video either on the Al-Maghrib Facebook page or on their YouTube channel under the Faith IQ section, where Sheikh Abu Isa answers that question. So that is what I wanted to share with you today, my dear brothers and sisters, the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Just to do a quick recap, that Ibrahim alayhi salam was sincere from a young age, and he had this deep-rooted conviction that brought about confidence, and thus he was able to give da'wah to his people. And he showed us that you shouldn't just preach to people and tell them what is right and wrong, but rather empower them to reach the truth themselves. He showed us the importance of having good akhlaq, particularly with our parents, even if they are disbelievers. And this applies to all close relatives that always want sincere goodness for them. Show them that love and respect, and it will go a long way. Through the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, we learned that it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who guides, and even the most beloved of prophets like Ibrahim alayhi salam were not able to control the guidance of their father, and thus he could not seek forgiveness for him even after he passed away. We learned from the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam the willingness to sacrifice, where if you have the willingness to sacrifice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always take care of your affairs, like he did in the situation of Hajar and providing for her in what she needed. And likewise in the story of Ismail, when he was commanded to slaughter him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced Ismail alayhi salam with a sheep. We learned a great lesson in humility, that even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to build the Kaaba, Ibrahim alayhi salam teaches Ismail and all of us the importance of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for acceptance. And in following that tradition, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from all of us our good deeds, forgives all of us for our sins and shortcomings, gives us tawfiq to worship him in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, and accepts from us the udhiya that we do for those of us that are able to do so, and that he makes us of those that celebrate with joy and iman and happiness the days of Eid, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to give us life till then. Allahumma ameen. Anything that I've said that is correct is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and all praise is due to him. And anything that I've said that is incorrect is from myself and shaitan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me and all of you. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. With that being said, we can now open up the floor for questions and answers. Barakallahu feekum.
Jazakumullahu khairan, Shaykhana. That was an extremely enlightening presentation. Jazakallahu khairan. And there's just so much to unpack, I believe, in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. It's just remarkable. So in terms of questions, alhamdulillah, we have a question over here, which you already touched upon. And that is, a sister says that we are already seeing emails that are asking to automate funds for the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, much like we know in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. So is there anything authentic, the sister asks, in the sunnah that giving sadaqah is specific in the first 10 days?
Excellent. Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you so much. So with regards to the specific question, as far as I know, there is no specific tradition that mentions the virtue of giving sadaqah in these 10 days. However, we are given a general guideline to do as much khair as we can, to do as much good as we can. And naturally, that would encompass the giving of sadaqah, the giving of sadaqah. What I also understood from her question is, you know, these charity organizations reaching out to automate their donations. And this is something that happens in Ramadan and happens in Dhul Hijjah as well. And some people may think that this is a form of bid'ah, that, you know, this is not something that was done by the Prophet ﷺ or by his companions. So it's very important to understand that why something like this actually is allowed. And over here, there is no ibadah that is being introduced that is different to the ibadah of the Prophet ﷺ. The only thing that is being done is the facilitation of automation, where basically you can set up an automatic donation that in these 10 days, you will give that. And I want to broaden the scope, a little bit of how we understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not stingy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is generous. So if someone makes the intention that they want to donate throughout all 10 days, and they make this intention, whether they are able to physically do it through all 10 days themselves and make that genuine determination and that intention to do so, or they automate the process, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows their intention. And that is what is rewarded first and foremost. So even if you automate it or not, if you made the intention to do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you more generously than you can possibly imagine. And that is what should be at the forefront of our minds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Jazakumullahu khairan. Excellent. Someone asked, this is more of a question towards me, that they missed the webinar, the initial presentation that the Sheikh was doing. Yes, sister, the recording is available and it is automatically uploaded onto National Zakat Foundation Canada's Facebook page. So the moment this webinar is done, you can navigate over to National Zakat Foundation Canada Facebook page, and you will find the recording over there, inshallah ta'ala. And those are the questions that we had, Sheikhana. I think, alhamdulillah, there's just so much that we can share, so much that we can discuss, and so much that we can, you know, just glean from the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. I believe that, subhanAllah, one or two webinars will never do justice to this, but thank you so much, Sheikh, for sharing all of those insights with us. And we beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gives us tawfiq to act upon what you presented and to act upon these beautiful lessons that you shared. And Allah azza wa jal gives us life to witness these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Jazakumullahu khair.
Amen. Barakallahu feekum. Jazakumullahu khair. And thank you so much for having me. Can I actually just ask something of you, if you don't mind? Please. Can you tell me what National Zakat Foundation is doing in these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, and if there's anything we can do to support them in these days of Dhul Hijjah? And then the last thing I will ask, and this actually I'll probably just do this now, can I just share two resources with the audience that have tuned in, if that's okay with you? Two things that I found really, really beneficial. One of them is more on the comical side and funny side. The other one is, mashallah, for the students of knowledge. Sheikh Ahsan Hanif, he actually did a great workshop on the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. I want to say about a week ago, this past weekend. It's on the Green Lane Masjid YouTube channel, and is perhaps one of the best presentations in terms of a detailed workshop on the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam that I've seen. And then the second thing is, if you're looking for something more humorous but still with valuable lessons, there is a chai chat with Sheikh Yasir Qadi that was done last Friday on the Miftah Institute Facebook page as well. and it has a lot of joking around. So like keep that, it's a chai chai at the end of the day, but there are some great lessons there as well. If you want something quick and funny at the same time, that's on the Miftah Institute Facebook page, inshallah. So now, Sheikh, I'm going to hand it over to you. Please tell us how we can support National Zakat Foundation in these 10 days and what they're up to, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum.
Wafiqum barakallah, jazakumullah khairan shaykhana, for sharing both of those resources. Inshallah, we'll check those out. The Sheikh mentioned Green Lane Masjid. Sheikh Ahsan Hanif talked about the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, an in-depth series, so we can benefit from there. And also something humorous on the lighthearted side, Miftah Institute Facebook page. So we will do that with Sheikh Dr. Yasir Qadi. As far as National Zakat Foundation is concerned, walillahil hamd, with the generous support of the Canadian community who has understood the immense and impactful work that National Zakat Foundation has been doing close to a decade now, walillahil hamd. We have impacted Muslims in over 90 cities just in the year 2020. And we've been able to distribute zakat and sadaqah to the most vulnerable in the community. So this Dhul Hijjah, we have a campaign that is going on, the Qurbani campaign. And the Qurbani campaign is geared towards feeding Muslims, needy Muslims in our own neighborhoods, locally. Zakat, or rather non-zakat, Qurbani meat will be distributed with your help. So the website, number one is nzfcanada.com/best10days. So you can log on to that website, nzfcanada.com/best10days. And then the second one that I'm putting over here in the chat is nzfcanada.com/qurbani. And these websites will give you in detail the activities that we are doing and the Qurbani meat that will be distributed to the people. Now, sometimes some questions, Sheikhana, that we get is, why is the price this much? And on certain other websites, we're seeing that doing the Qurbani overseas actually costs, you know, this amount, and yours seems to be higher. So the fact of the matter is that because our absolute focus is local, so these are local Canadian dollar values that, by the way, takes care of the entire procedure from the slaughtering of the animal to the cutting of the meat to the skinning to the packaging to the distribution to the transportation, even to the families that are in need. So that is why the fee you are seeing on the website, inshallah, in the manner that they are. So nzfcanada.com/best10days and nzfcanada.com/qurbani, Q-U-R-B-A-N-I. So make sure that you spread the word far and wide.
Sheikh, jazakumullah khairan, thank you so much. And I think that's a very important point to highlight, that we should be supporting our local community first and foremost before doing things overseas. I mean, there are general exceptions. Yes, if you have family members overseas, by all means, help them first. But unless that is the case, try to support local, as this was the command of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Now, to turn it on a quick humorous note, Sheikh, have you ever done the udhiya or the qurbani yourself?
I have, with a bunch of brothers, and this was actually in the States when I was a student there. And subhanAllah, Sheikhana, what a mission, because we are so inexperienced.
Subhanallah, subhanAllah. It is definitely something challenging. And I think, you know, for men, they're like, yeah, I can do this so easily, it's going to be a piece of cake. But when that animal is in front of you and you have the knife, it's a completely different story. So if I can quickly share my own experience, I was about 9 years old, and I was in Pakistan with my grandfather, rahimahullah, and they literally just brought the goat to the house. And they're like, Navaid, we want you to do the sacrifice. Being a 9-year-old kid, I was like, sure, I'd love to do this, till I got the knife. And you see, like, in the eyes of the goat, that it was like petrified, like it was scared out of his mind. And I'm like, I don't want to do this anymore. And my grandfather's like, no, you have to do this. And he took my hand, and with his hand, we did Bismillah, Allahu Akbar. And I would say, to a certain degree, it was almost like a traumatic event, because I was crying. I'm like, I don't want to do this anymore. And that sort of stayed with me. And then the next opportunity, and thereafter, when we moved to Canada, you know, we always use the local grocery store to get our qurbani done. Up until when I got to Medina, and the first year when we went for Hajj, they used to have the like the farmhouses that are just by Mina in that area. And again, I was like, you know what? Maybe I want to try to go do my qurbani again. But this time when I got there, in the days of Hajj, the blood was just overflowing. And all those traumatic memories came back. And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to buy the ticket. That used to be able to buy a ticket for 375 riyals. And I'm like, we're just going to do that. And so I never did it again. Allahul Mustaan. But inshallah, I'm hoping that one day, when my own son Abdullah grows older, that I can experience this again, inshallah.
Ameen. Inshallah ta'ala, Shaykhana, that's one thing I think we miss out on here in North America because of the mandates and the health rulings in place, which alhamdulillah, we respect. But I feel that whole festivities surrounding, you know, qurbani, that is lost. But again, we also see then arguments on the other side, again, from practicing Muslims, that we have to ensure that we treat the animal with respect. And we, even if we're doing the udhiyah, we're showing our 10-year-old, our 7-year-old, our 6-year-old kids that this, we are doing it for the sake of Allah. And the meat will go to the needy. And he said, sometimes we're there at the farmhouse and it's just people just going all kinds of, you know, they don't even have the proper training in how to do it. I remember, Shaykhna, as you mentioned, this was in Houston, Texas, when a bunch of, you know, brothers, they were trying to slaughter a full-sized bull. And I'm like, subhanAllah, I hope they know what they're doing. And the way that they were, they're trying to slaughter it, I think it was absolutely, the knife itself wasn't that sharp, they weren't even doing it, and this is a big animal, so if only they had someone to, you know, to help them out. So sometimes I just feel, subhanAllah, that here in North America, because we don't get experienced butchers helping out at every stall, maybe that's a project we need to take on next.
Of course, and I think this is something that, you know, often we're ignorant of. But the dhabiha process begins way before the animal itself, making sure that the knife is sharp, making sure that you don't show the animal up until it's the time for slaughter, making sure you don't slaughter one animal in front of the other, making sure that the animal has not eaten any impurities for at least 40 days prior to the slaughtering. And then when you're doing the udhiyah itself, you say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, while it's held down and unable to move. And also making sure that the artery and the windpipe are cut together at the same time, to facilitate the blood flow out and to make sure that it's at the least painful possible experience for the animal itself. So you're definitely 100% right. It is an education process that needs to be shared with the community and also those that slaughter the animals.
SubhanAllah, Allah accept from all of us. Allah make
Ameen, ya
Jazakumullah khair, Shaykhana, for sharing those anecdotes and those stories. I think, inshallah, we should plan a little bit of a chai chat soon with you.
Bismillah, anytime, Shaykh, with you. It would be my pleasure, inshallah.
Thank you so much. Barakallahu feekum. I hope everybody else enjoyed and benefited. Keep all of us at National Zakat Foundation in your du'as, the Shaykh, his family in your du'as as well. Thank you so much. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته